Okay, let's start.
So last time we just entered chapter 9 and discussed about this unbiasedness in your estimator. So here, so currently our overall story at this point is, so we started from the population, right? The entire population that contains the entire sample or entire individuals. And then we obtain some sample, which is a subset of a population. And then we compute some function called a statistic, right? So given maybe 10 samples that you obtained, and then you compute maybe sample mean and sample variance or some other statistic, which is just another function. Okay? And here in this case, in chapter 9, we actually we consider the goal of this statistic. So statistic, which is just a function of these sample, has some kind of goal. And the goal is to estimate some true parameter that underlying in your true distribution by using this statistic. So statistic, we actually utilize this statistic as a kind of estimator for a true parameter. So in the case of sample mean, we can think of this guy as a kind of proxy information. So that is a kind of approximate version of the true mean mu, right? So in this case where we use this statistic as an estimator of some unknown parameter, theta, and then we call that as a estimator. And then in this context of using this statistic as an estimator, we consider like two different properties. So the first property is called this unbiasedness. So unbiasedness is as follows. So this statistic is a function of samples, and those samples are random variable. So statistic is a function of these random variable, and so statistic is also a random variable. So as we saw in the previous chapter, this case of a sample mean, when transforming this sample mean in this form, this guy followed the normal standard normal random variable, right? So that means given fixed mu and sigma and the number of sample n, this sample mean, which is one kind of a statistic, that is also a random variable. And that random variable, after this transformation, follows this standard normal random variable, right? So based on the fact that this guy, this x bar or statistic, is also another a random variable, we can consider their mean and the variance, right? And so using this mean and the variance, we study these two properties of unbiasedness and also efficiency of the estimator. So this unbiasedness is, on average, this statistic and their expectation value will be exactly the same as this true parameter mu that we want to estimate using this sample mean. Okay? So what if we do not satisfy this equation? And there could be two cases. This could be greater than mu or smaller than mu. And in this case, the meaning of this case is that on average, your sample mean or your statistic is actually larger than the true parameter mu. So in most of the cases, you are kind of overestimating the true parameter that you want to estimate, right? So if the mu was 170, and then your sample mean could be slightly larger than this 170 on average, okay? So that is an overestimated, that is an overestimated case. And so in this case, it's a certainty, it's a biased, right? Because your sample mean is generally giving you larger value than the true parameter mu. And in this case, we are calling this as an underestimated or, underestimated case. So in both of these cases, these are biased, right? But in this case, on average, your statistic is having this average of the true parameter, the same as the true parameter value. We call that as an unbiased estimator. Okay, so the next property is this efficiency. So in this definition, we call this a most efficient estimator. So in this case, we consider the variance of your statistic. So X bar has the mean and the variance, because that's one kind of random variable. So in general, when the purpose, purpose is to estimate some unknown parameter theta using your statistic based on your sample, right? So in this case, in order to properly estimate this unknown parameter's theta, the variance of X bar or statistic could be, it would be generally better if the variance of your statistic is smaller. Okay? So that means, intuitively, given your parameter theta, unknown parameter theta is 170, and then suppose, we consider multiple surveying company, what A, B, and C, and so on. Suppose their sample mean, X bar, was 169.5, 170, 0.3, and 168.9, okay? So those are the sample means collected from these three surveying companies, okay? In some other scenarios, given the same, exact same value of unknown parameter, their estimator or their sample mean was as follows. So 150, 180, and 190. Okay, so in all these cases, they have approximately the same mean of 170, right? But in this case, their variance, when considering the distribution of these sample means, so the variance is much smaller in the first case than in the second case. So in the case of second one, each of these values might be likely much farther from the true value of 170, right? So it means we cannot rely, we cannot trust each of these values. So suppose, so here the situation is we cannot have multiple surveying companies. So we can have only one surveying company. And so you can have only one of the sample mean. And then you have to rely on this value in order to estimate or guess the true parameter theta. Okay, so in this case, if the variance was large, and then it means each of the sample mean is less trustworthy, or you cannot trust much on each values, right? So that way, if the variance is smaller, and that means your sample mean is more closer to the true mean value, true parameter value theta, right? So here in this case, we consider most efficient, the most efficient estimator for this theta. Okay, so let's consider this situation. So you want to estimate the true mean value of a person's height. Okay, and then so again, we consider three surveying companies, but in the first case, we use this sample statistic called the sample mean in order to estimate the parameter theta, or as an estimator, we picked up the sample mean, okay? But we can consider the other case, another case, where we use something like this. We can consider the median. So out of maybe 10 samples for each company, we just pick up the middle value or the median value, and then we consider this as another estimator for the same parameter theta. Okay, so in this case, clearly the sample mean and the sample median is a two different estimator for a same unknown parameter theta, right? So we can consider these kind of two different scenarios, right? And then let's consider the third scenario. So yeah, instead of using a sample mean or the median value, you can kind of just an average between x mean and the max value. So it means, so you collect 10 different persons' height, and then you pick up the minimum and maximum value and take the average between those two values, and then utilize that value as an estimator, another estimator for this same parameter theta. So from these cases, we can consider different estimators for estimating the same parameter theta, right? And then for each of these statistic or estimator, we can consider whether each of them are biased, and also how big each of this random variable has the is a variance. I mean, how big the variance of each random variable has. Okay. So yeah, even though we do not prove these, but you can easily think, yeah, you can easily agree that on average, the mean value of each statistic or each estimator will be the same as the true parameter theta. Okay, so in that sense, all these estimator will be unbiased. Okay, but what about their variance? So this random variable will have its own variance, and this guy will also have the different value of a variance, and this one will also have a variance, right? And so as we discussed in the previous slide, smaller variance will be better, because that means each of the sample statistic will be more closer to the true parameter theta. Okay, so in these cases, which one will have the smallest variance? So that is the notion of this efficiency. And among all the possible estimator for the same parameter theta, we can pick up, or we can think about the best one in terms of their variance, which means the best one will have the smallest variance for this estimator, okay? So for that estimator, we call that as the most efficient estimator. So efficiency means small variance. So in these cases, can anyone guess which one is the most efficient estimator among these three? So again, the goal is to estimate the true unknown parameter theta, but we consider the sample mean. So suppose each company collected 10 samples, and then the first estimator is to compute the sample mean, and then the second estimator is just to pick up the median value, and then the third estimator is to just take the average between the minimum and maximum values. Which one will have the smallest variance among these three? Yeah, so yeah, again, in this case, I cannot prove rigorously, but in terms of the variance, or the closest one to the true parameter theta is the first one, okay? So the first one is the most efficient one among these three, okay? Okay, so let's understand this from this PDF of this statistic. Okay, so this is the true parameter data, and then let's consider these three estimator. So for example, this one could be sample mean, and this one could be like a median, and this one is the minimum, the average between the minimum and maximum values. So in terms of a biasness, data 1 and data head 1, data head 2 seems to be unbiased, because their mean value will be exactly the same as the true parameter data. In the case of data head 3, their mean is clearly different from data. So is it overestimating or underestimating the true parameter data? It's overestimating it, because on average, it will give you the larger value than the true parameter data. Okay? And then for these unbiased estimators, which one is a more efficient one? The efficient one is the first one, because it will have smaller or narrower variance, right? So it means, again, when obtaining one sample from this distribution of a statistic, the value will be likely to be closer to this data compared to data head 2. Okay, these two are very, very important notion of this estimator, biasness and also efficiency. So yeah, for those one, I mean, for those notions, we will not extend much on these notions, and we will turn to the actual examples, not talking too much about these estimators' properties. But in the future, as you take some statistics or probability courses, and then you might see some estimator called BLUE, and also MVUE. Okay. So the first one is not just a color, it's an acronym standing for Best Linear Unbiased Estimator. Okay, so it's all ending with the E, which is an estimator. And then the first one is Best Linear Unbiased Estimator, which means best means the most efficient one, okay, which has the smallest variance. And then also linear means your statistic is actually a linear function of your sample, okay? And then U is an unbiased one, okay? And also this guy, MVUE, is also having almost the same meaning, minimum variance unbiased estimator. So U still means unbiased, and then MV means minimum variance, which means the most efficient one. Okay, yeah, so this one is actually having the unbiasedness and also the best, the most efficient one. Okay, so in that sense, it's probably the best estimator out there. And then the first one is We only think about the linear estimator, and then among those linear estimators, we consider the most efficient one and then unbiased one. Okay, so okay, so it's missing some equations. So let's briefly check the equations. Okay, so we now think about the sample mean. Okay, so we still think about this sample mean, and then we actually use the sample mean as an estimator for the true parameter. True parameter mu. Okay, so from the central limit theorem, by using the sample mean after this transformation, and then it will follow this normal distribution with the zero mean and the standard unit standard deviation, Okay? And then we can consider this kind of a confidence interval, which means this random variable is lying between this guy and this guy, will have the probability of 1 minus alpha. So it means, I think you guys already learned about this in your high school. But suppose, so this guy is the PDF of this random variable. And then this blue area covers 95% of the entire region, or the area itself is 0.95. Okay, so in this case, your random variable, this guy, lying between these ranges, will have the probability of 0.95. Okay, and then what was this guy? So what was the meaning of this? So let's remind ourselves about what this meaning is. So this one means, so we have a Z and it's a PDF, and then this value will be corresponding to the area above a certain value, okay? And then this, when this value is the same as alpha over 2, and then the corresponding x value of this random variable, and this one, suppose this one was like 3.5, and then this one was like 0.05, and then, for example, this guy, z of 0.05, it will mean 3.5. Okay, so that is the meaning of this guy. And so here we consider alpha as, for example, like 5%. Okay, so we want to cover almost all the areas, for example, 95% of the entire probability. Okay, so this random variable will be sampled between these regions with the probability of 95. But for the other 5% of the probability, you will have the samples outside of these regions. Okay, so that is the meaning of this 95%. And so we can understand this equation. Okay. And then we can manipulate this guy into this form. So the expression that we have in the parentheses, that can be manipulated into this form. Okay, let me just turn it off. Okay, so from this expression, we obtain this expression, and then this expression has a kind of meaning in the context of a estimator. So here the goal is we want to estimate the true parameter mu using this sample mean that we obtained as a kind of survey company A. And then the probability of the true mean lying between these two values will have the probability of 0.95. Okay, so that means if your sample mean was 169, and then this value was 2, and this value was maybe 3. Okay, so in this case, mu is, the range for mu is 169 minus 3.2, 3 times 2, and then 169 plus 3 times 2. And so your true mean is lying between 163 and 175. Okay? The probability of your true mean lying between these two ranges, or two of these values, the probabilities of this case will be 95%. Okay. So in other words, with a 95 confidence, so you are confident with the 95% of the probability, and then you can confidently say that the true mean is ranging between 163 and 175. Okay, so so this guy is actually called interval estimate. Okay. So again, as a survey company A, you obtain the sample mean of 169. And then you can just simply say that the true mean will be 169, okay? But the actual probability of the true mean having this exact sample mean will be almost zero, right? So we can kind of guess that the true mean is somewhere around the sample mean value, but it will be difficult to say true parameter mu is exactly the same as 169, okay? So saying this single value for your parameter theta or mu is called a point estimate, which means you are using just one single number to give an estimate of the true parameter. But in this case, we are giving some kind of interval, right? Or interval for the potential ranges of the true parameter mu. So in this case, we call this as an interval estimate. Okay, so, yeah, and then let's discuss why we see alpha over 2, okay? So the story is as follows. So we want to be confident with the 95%. And then we are losing 5% of the 5% of the rare cases. And then we want to distribute this 5% into the left and the right side of these extreme values, okay? So in this case, we are distributing this guy with the 5% divided by 2 on this part and this part as well. And so this guy is alpha, and then the corresponding region for this will be alpha over 2. So we have to consider the z value or x value that has the area of alpha over 2 on the right. Okay, so that's why we see this alpha over 2 here. Let's see. Okay, and then so this figure is quite informative when understanding what you're doing in this interval estimate given by this equation, okay? Or for example, like this equation, okay? So suppose the survey company A obtained the sample mean as 169, and then it will give you the range of 163 to 175. And then suppose the survey company B obtained 173. And then this range for the true parameter mu will be changing as 173 minus 3.2, and then 173 plus 3 times 2. Okay, so it means we have a new range of 167 to 179. Okay, so these one, it will be clearly a different range from this. So depending on different survey company and their different sample means. So suppose this guy has the, this guy are the different sample means from different surveying companies. And then from survey company A, it will give you this interval estimate for the true mean. And then for the survey company B, it will give you this range. Okay? But here, let's focus on what is changing and what is fixed one. So the changing one is actually the random variable or the sample mean in this case, which is this guy. This guy, right? So these are different sample means from obtained from different surveying companies. So these are the random variables that changes. Okay? But the true parameter mu is a fixed one. So that is just a fixed constant value. And that constant value is represented as this fixed line mu. Okay? But here in this case, even though the range changes depending on different surveying companies, like in the case of surveying company A, they gave you this range. Okay, but the surveying company B, it gave you different ranges. But most likely, with the 95% of the probability, they will capture the true mean, which is the fixed one within that interval estimate from different surveying companies. Okay, so in this manner, they are all, yeah, covering or containing this true mean value mu. Okay, then there are some other cases like this guy. Okay, so this guy unfortunately didn't cover the true mean value mu, right? So that's corresponding to the rare case of a 5% of the probability. Okay, so out of 100 surveying companies, 95 companies will capture the true mean value from their interval estimates, but only the five of the companies will not capture the true mean mu. And then we can consider this notion of an error, which is the difference of the true mean value and then the sample mean when still using the point estimate. So point estimate was 167, which is our sample mean in this case. And then this guy is called error because that is the difference between the sample mean and the true mean value mu. Okay, and then so here we again consider the point estimate. Point estimate this x bar, and then this x bar is used an estimate of the true parameter mu, and then we are 95% confident that the error will not exceed these amount. So we will give you this interval estimate, right? So it was like 169 minus 2 times 3, 169 plus 2 times 3. So it's a multiplier. Okay, and so the maximum value between this sample mean and this maximum value and the minimum value. So the length of this interval. Okay? So that is our maximum error. And then we can guarantee with the 95%, or we can be 95% confident that the error, which is the difference between the true mean and the sample mean, will not exceed these amount. So these amount is just the same as this guy, right? that gives you the interval estimate. And then we can also let's see, we can also think about the specified amount of an error. So here the situation is, someone gave you the value for the error. So someone gave you, your boss gave you, the error shouldn't be less than maybe 5 centimeters. Okay? So in this case, if we want to be 95% confident, and then the error can be as large as 6 centimeters, okay? But your boss says this error should be less than 5 centimeters, right? So in this case, we have to do something. So between these two, the first one is not actually changing, but what we can change is this second one, right? And from second one, this guy, the true sigma value will not change, because that's assumed to be the true parameter for variance or the standard deviation of the x. But we can actually change this guy, which is our sample size or the number of samples. So by increasing this value of an n, we can change, or we can decrease this value into a smaller value. So this value can be reduced by increasing the sample size. Okay, and then in this case, what will be the minimum number of samples, or what will be the required sample size in order to guarantee the error is no more than 5 centimeter with 95% of confidence. Okay. So in this case, so it is simple. So alpha over 2 times C sigma. This guy. So, see, alpha over 2 times sigma over square root n. So this guy should be the specified error e, which is like a 5 centimeter in our case, right? So in this case, we can solve for this n. So we remove, we move this guy into denominator on this guy, and this guy moves to the right. And then we just take the square of it, and then we will obtain this guy. Okay. Okay. Then now move on. Let's move on to another case where the sigma is unknown this time. So previously we used the true sigma value. So in the previous case, we assumed that the true sigma value is kind of known. Okay. But in this case, what if we do not know the true sigma value? In this case, the typical scenario is to change this x bar minus mu and sigma divided by square root n. So this guy was following the standard normal random variable. But in this case, we do not know this sigma. And so, our best is to replace this guy by the sample variance. Okay? So that sample variance is denoted as S. Okay? So what was S? So just let's recall that S squared was xi minus x bar squared. Then we just take the summation of it and then divide it by n minus 1, right? So this one was our sample variance. And then we just take the square root of it in order to change it to standard deviation. And so instead of using the true sigma, we actually use this estimated sample variance. But in this case, this distribution, when using the sample variance, this one is now becoming a t, student t random variable, right? So instead of a standard normal random variable, it became the t, student t random variable following the t distribution. And then we looked at the properties. We studied the properties of this t distribution that have heavier tails on the extreme values compared to the Gaussian distribution, okay? So that was kind of a high-level story that we learned in the previous chapter when changing this true sigma into the sample variance, S. Okay, so this one is now our student t random variable. And then student t distribution had a parameter, one single parameter, that is called degrees of freedom. And that degrees of freedom is actually the same as the number of samples minus 1. Okay? So that was a kind of story about how we how we change this guy into the student t random variable. And then also separate from this, we also learned about the properties of the t distribution. So in general, without even thinking about these statistics, which is based on this sample mean and the sample variance, apart from that, we also learned about the properties of this student t distribution. And what was a student t distribution? And the, what was the meaning of it? The meaning of it was this guy. So we define the student t distribution or the random variable t as this guy, z and v over n. And then here in this case, z is following the standard normal random variable. And then v is following chi-square distribution, where the degree of freedom is n. Okay, and then this chi-square distribution, and the meaning of it is yeah, so this is the meaning of the t distribution. So we thought about this chi-squared distribution, right? And this v is chi-squared distribution with the degree of v. And in this case, when degree of freedom v is n, okay, let's not use n, and then let's just use v, then. So suppose v was 5, and then the chi-square distribution is actually the squared sum of standard normal random variable and their distribution. And then the total number of standard normal random variable that are added together, okay, that is determining, that determines our degree of freedom for this chi-square distribution. Okay, so that is a physical meaning of this chi-square distribution. And then we consider this chi-square distribution and then divide it by n. And this means approximately approximately the average value of the squared standard normal random variable. Okay? And this is kind of similar, or that will approximately the same as what? What should that be? Okay, so let me ask the question in the other way. So you consider the standard random variable, standard normal random variable, and then you consider the five standard normal random variables. And then what will be the mean of each value? Each value, the mean of each random variable will be 0. And then standard deviation or the variance will have 1 for each of these values. Okay? And then you sample, you obtain the 5 samples from this standard random variable. And then you just take the square of them. Okay, you just take the square of them and then sum them up and then divide it by 5. So it means the average value of z squared, right? And then what will be the average value of z squared? Approximately, what will be the value of it? Okay, then let me ask the question in a simpler form, simpler way. So you consider one single standard random, standard normal random variable. And then you just take the square of it. And then what's the average value of it? Or what's the average value of z squared? Z is a, where z is a standard normal random variable. So yeah, if you don't know the answer will be likely either 0 or 1, right? It'll be 0. 1. Okay. So it will be 1. So in the case of just the average or expectation value of z, and then it will be 0, right? But the, what about this? This one is actually the same as the variance. Why? Because z minus 0, which is the average value of it, and then square of it. And then that is, and then we consider the expectation of it. That is actually the variance of this random variable z, right? And then the variance is 1 squared. And so this one will be 1, and then minus 0 will be gone, right? So it means z squared and expectation of z squared will be 1, right? So yeah, let's think about the meaning of these, this expectation. So what is the expectation? So you obtain infinite number of z squared and then take the average of it, and then that will value that value will be approximately 1, right? We can all, yeah, of course, solve this analytically by utilizing the integral with the complicated Gaussian probability density function, right? But in practice, or empirically, from when considering our samples, the meaning of this guy is we obtain infinitely many samples of z squared, and then take the average of it, and then that value will be approximately 1, right? Okay, so back to this point where we consider the definition of this chi-square distribution. And so this guy is our chi-square distribution, right? And then we just divide it. Okay, so this one should be just V, okay? So from this, we consider the infinitely many samples. But here in this case, we only consider the 5 samples. And then just sum up the z squared values from these five samples. Okay, and then we just divide it by 5. And this value will be approaching to 1. Because if v goes to infinity, and then this one will have exactly the same meaning as this guy. But in this case, we only consider 5 samples, which is much, much smaller than the infinite number, right? So this one, this value might vary, or this value might fluctuate, right? This one, this value might be much less than 1 or larger than 1, and so on, right? But it cannot be less than 0, because we are considering the squared sum, right? But these values will be fluctuating around 1, right? But if v goes to infinity, then this one will be exactly just 1. So even though we... Yeah, so let's just find... Yeah, so this is the PDF, or probability density function, of a chi-squared distribution, right? And then different color is depending on different k values. So as k gets larger, the distribution gets wider, and then it looks like the mean value will be shifting to the right. So mean value is increasing, right? But this is just a chi-squared distribution, and then we consider this chi-squared distribution divided by the k, or the degree of freedom, right? And then this red one, or this red distribution, will be shrunken by the factor of 9. And then this blue one will be shrunken by the factor of 4, okay? And for all these distribution, we'll have the peak at the x value of 1, because we know this value will be approaching 1 as n gets infinity, or the degree of freedom gets larger and larger. Okay, so if we consider this PDF divided, shrunken by the factor of the degrees of freedom, and then it will be a sharper and sharper distribution centered around 1. Right? But that should be true because of how we formed,
because of this definition of this chi-squared distribution divided by V. Okay?
Okay, so now we understood this chi-squared distribution. And then, the version of the chi-squared distribution divided by V. Okay, and then it's time to move back to this original T distribution and this meaning. Let's see. So in this case, so we have this standard normal random variable, and then divide it by this denominator, and this denominator has the form of a square root of v over n, or n is the degree of freedom for our chi-squared distribution, and then this value inside of this square root, again, this value will be approximately 1 if n gets larger and larger, because this value is the same as this value, right? And so it's like we divide
the standard normal random variable by just 1, right? Because the denominator is just approaching to 1, right? So it seems to have no effect. But it's only true when n gets larger and larger. But what if n is a relatively small value, like a 5 or 10 or so? In that case, this denominator will no longer be 1. That will also fluctuate, as I mentioned, right? So that will fluctuate. So that will influence this standard normal random variable in a certain manner. So it can exaggerate the standard normal random variable, or it can make the standard normal value smaller, right? Because, yeah, it's just a simple one. So if this one gets exactly 1, and then it will have no effect, but if it was 0.7, and then it will make this z value larger, right? Because we divide it by 0.7. And then if this value was 1.3, and then it will make the z value smaller, right? So that way, it plays a certain role of influencing this standard normal random variable z, okay? So in those cases, what will be the probability density function and their behavior of it? That is this definition of t distribution. Okay? So this is the meaning or physical meaning of the t distribution. And then back to this slide. This standard this definition where we consider this a sample mean and the sample variance and setting up this expression. This expression is actually following this the t distribution, where the degree of freedom is n minus 1. Okay, so it is like we consider this a standard normal random variable divided by v divided by n minus 1, where v is chi-square distribution and z is a standard normal random variable. Okay, so I think this is quite an important point. So yeah, I spent some time in explaining this guy today, but the overall derivation of the relationship between these two, we studied this already in the previous chapter. Okay, so if you are not clear about these, and then please refer to the book, and then closely to follow this derivation. Okay, and then once we understood, this guy follows the t distribution instead of just a standard normal random variable. Okay, so again, the story is, let's see, in this case, when using the true sigma, and then we consider this as central limit theorem, and in this case, we utilize this standard normal random variable, but in this expression, if we change the true sigma with this sample variance, and then it will become the t distribution, but the remaining story will be still the same. So we have a different distribution of this t distribution instead of Gaussian random variable, but still we want to consider from this distribution, we want to obtain the interval estimate of this mu, ranging from some value to some other value, okay? So after manipulating these equations, we will have this equation, okay? So this guy came from this equation. So let me just write this equation. X bar minus mu divided by S divided by square root n. This guy is following the t distribution, and so alpha over 2 we'll have probability of 1 minus alpha. So when alpha was 0.05, and this guy will be 95%, and this guy will be 0.05. Okay, and then also the t distribution is also the symmetric, and so we divide equally this amount of probability of 0.05 into like 0.025 and then 0.025 equally. Okay, so this value is t of alpha over 2, and this guy is minus t alpha over 2. Okay, and then this distribution is again the t distribution where the degree is n minus 1, and n is the number of samples, degrees of freedom, I mean. Yeah, questions so far? Okay, so from both cases, in this case, yeah, in this slide, we learned the new term of standard error, or in short, S dot E dot. Okay, so in both cases, when the sigma was known or sigma has to be replaced by the sample variance, that had almost the same form. So x bar plus minus. So in the case of sigma squared known, and then we consider this guy, alpha over 2, sigma, and then square root divided by square root n. Okay? And then in the case of sigma squared unknown, we consider this interval estimate. And then if we consider, if we compare these two expressions, and then we have a standard normal random variable, but we have t random variable. Okay? And then see. We have this term, and here we have this term, okay? And then these two terms are actually called this standard error of x bar. And this term was considered as the variance of this sample mean. Right. So again, in the case of CLT, we considered x bar minus mu because that had the true mean value of mu, and then we divided it by sigma over square root n. Because this guy is actually the standard deviation value of sample mean. Right. So again, this value is the standard deviation of x bar. And then what about this t distribution? We still have the same expression on the numerator, but in the case of denominator, we replace sigma by s, or sample standard deviation, divided by square root n. And so in this case, we can view x bar as having this standard deviation. So those terms are just having another name of a standard error, or S dot E dot. Okay, so standard error means, standard error is another name of standard deviation when your random variable is this estimator. Okay, so you consider your estimator. So in this specific case, you consider this a sample mean, right? And then the sample mean, whether it follows this standard normal random variable or it follows this t distribution, that will have a certain amount of variance or standard deviation, right? That standard deviation for your estimator is called standard error, okay? So when if we use another estimator, for example, like a median value, and then it will have its own variance. When so we considered it already in the context of this efficiency of the estimator, and so the variance of this estimator or statistic is called this standard error. Okay, so this interval estimate is composed of two parts. One coming from the distribution that this estimator is following, whether it was a standard random variable, standard normal, or student t distribution, okay? And then another component is just the variance itself of your estimator x bar, okay? So that is the meaning of this standard error. Okay. Then the next one is prediction interval. So the prediction interval is considering a slightly different problem. So here, so the data is streaming in this case. So you are in the middle of collecting more and more samples. So you are surveying company A, and then until yesterday, you collected 99 samples, and then you could compute this sample mean only using the 99 samples that you obtained until yesterday. Okay, and then suppose that sample mean was 167. Okay, and then we can also think about the true mean value and true standard true variance value of individual xi's, right? But here the problem is, given this situation where we only know the sample mean of this the previous sample that we obtained, and also mu and sigma squared, and then what will be the interval estimate of another sample that we will obtain today? So suppose we obtain one sample at a time, or one sample per day, and then for the last 99 days, you obtained 99 samples, and then up to that point, you computed this sample mean, and then in the next day, you will obtain another sample. But here, the goal is to predict what will be the interval for your new sample. Okay? So, So the question is, what is the range of new sample? Let's denote the new sample that we obtained today as x0. And then, what will be the interval estimate of this new sample, or just one single new sample based on these information? Okay, so that is the problem setting. Okay, so I kindly prepared for note, although it's handwritten. Okay, so we consider this statistic, which is the difference between the new sample that we obtained, which is just a single sample, and then another statistic, which is just a sample mean up to yesterday's sample. Okay, and then let's consider the distribution that this guy is following. And then in this case, we have two parts, and each of them is random variables. Okay, so in the case of x bar minus mu, we only had one random variable. And mu was just a fixed parameter value. So that is just a constant one. That is not changing because that is not random variable, right? But when considering this equation, both of these x0 and x bar will be random variables. So we have two different random variables. And then we have to consider the distribution of this difference between these two random variables. Okay? So this guy will be following the standard normal, normal distribution with the mean, the true mean mu, and the variance, the true variance of sigma squared, of course, right? And then what about this x bar? X bar will follow the normal distribution, but their mean will be staying the same as the true parameter mu, but their variance will change as sigma squared divided by n, right? So we know this sample mean is following or having this true variance, okay? And then for this equation, this expression, we are considering the difference between the two random variables, and each of them are normal random variable. So x0 is normal and x bar is also normal. And their mean value is the same as mu, right? And their different, their variance will be different as sigma squared and sigma squared divided by n. Okay? And so, yeah, the normal distribution has a kind of quite a convenient properties. So you consider like a two different normal distribution and their random variables. And then you just take the addition of it, or you just take the difference, or the you just subtract between them. Okay, so you just add or subtract between different normal distribution or normal random variable. And then the resulting random variable, that is subtraction or the addition of multiple normal random variable, and then this random variable will also be normal random variable. Okay, so normal, normal plus normal will be normal. Normal minus normal will be also normal. Okay, and so we can, we know the class of this, or we know this random variable is following the normal random variable, and then what is the mean value and the variance. So here, the mean value, and this is a typo, not the typo, handwritten typo. It should be zero, because the mean value, we know this, right? X bar, X naught, X zero is also called X naught. Okay, so if you hear naught, then please don't get confused. Naught means zero, okay? So that's why we call this x0 and x0 as well. X0 minus x bar. So x bar is the sample mean up to 99 samples. Okay? Then we consider the expectation of this guy will be, and then will be this guy, right? Then we know this guy is mu, this guy is mu, because x bar is unbiased estimator. Okay, so mu minus mu will become zero. So the difference between x naught minus x bar will have the zero mean. And then what about the variance? So the variance will be just the squared sum between these two. The variance will be just a summation of the two variances from these two random variables. And then those two are statistically independent, right? So you can, intuitively, the new sample will not be dependent on the previous 99 samples that you obtained. So those two random variables are statistically independent, and thus the covariance value will be zero, right? And so the variance of this random variable will be just simply the summation of the variances of these two, right? So the variance will become this guy, okay? Okay, and then we manipulate this kind of equation, so we can have this kind of an interval estimate for this new sample. Okay, so here the new sample is ranging. I mean, they are centered at x bar. Okay, but their kind of error will be this value. Okay. So yeah, although it looks quite difficult, I mean it looks quite tricky, but it's really simple. So you just applied this variance in the place of standard error part. Okay? So what was the standard error? Standard error was this guy, right? Standard error was the standard deviation of your estimator, or sample mean in this case, right? So in this case, this random variable will have this variance, and so the standard error will be just square root of sigma squared plus sigma squared divided by n. And so we factor sigma squared out as sigma, and then the remaining part will become 1 plus 1 over n. Okay? So again, the meaning of this interval estimate is you obtained up to 99 samples and you computed their sample mean. And then what will be the new sample and their interval estimate given the sample mean of the previous samples? Okay? Okay, and then let's look at one property or one behavior of this guy. So in this case, we can consider like different situations depending on the number of previous samples. So in this specific case, we assume that we obtained 99 samples. So we obtained 99 samples and their sample mean, and then want to estimate the intervals of the new sample, right? But let's think about another case where we have 99 samples. Okay, in this case, still suppose x bar was 167. In this case, let's look at this interval estimate. Interval estimate will have the fixed value of sigma, and this is also fixed one, right? So those two values are not something that we can change, so they are all constant. And then one is also constant, but this part, okay? So this part will have, so in the previous case, n was 99, it means 1 plus 1 over 99 is actually determining your standard error, the intervals, right, of your interval estimate. But what about this case where we have really, really large number of samples? And then this 1 over n will go to 0 as n gets larger and larger, right? And so this interval, I mean the width of this interval gets smaller and smaller, right? But it cannot be smaller than this. Yeah, we just, let's remove them because that was approximately zero when n was really, really large. In that case, this part, yeah, this specific case will give you the smallest possible width of your interval estimate, right? So that is quite obvious. And also, as n gets larger and larger, this interval estimate will get smaller and smaller. So smaller interval estimate will be better, right? Because that will give you more information, right? So your x value or the true mean value is between 169 and 171. I mean, that's much better than saying your true mean value is between 150 and 190, okay? So there are so many possibilities because this interval is so large, right? So interval is generally much better when the interval is smaller and smaller. And in this case, n gets larger and larger. Your new point and their interval estimate will get smaller and smaller. Okay, so that is one kind of interesting aspect about this prediction interval of the new sample. So this one, we are learning kind of boring statistic and a probability in this class, but. Here we saw the term called prediction, right? Suddenly, prediction is really an interesting topic, right? As you know, all the machine learning and artificial intelligence is 99% about all the prediction, right? So most of the machine learning and artificial intelligence is about the prediction, right? And so in this case of this prediction of interval estimate of the new sample, will have a kind of important role, right? So this one is one kind of interesting application of this kind of technique is some control theory. And control theory, if you heard about something like a common filter, and also like so Kalman filter, and also other control theory kind of techniques. So common filter or this control theory is doing it something like this. So suppose you know the missile that tracks some object, right? So you launch a missile and that actually tracks an enemy airplane, right? And then even if this guy is moving around and this guy tracks really well, and then right on target, explodes on the right target, right? So that is based on this kind of prediction thing, right? So we constantly predict the new location of that target object. So it has moved this way, and so I will get a new sample mean. And so the next sample, which means the next position of that airplane, will be estimated based on this kind of technique. Okay. although it is really really difficult to imagine how this exact formula is utilized in tracking the enemy airplane. But this is the very basic technique, and then the fundamental ideas will remain the same even for those complicated tasks. Okay, in this case, if we had this prediction interval when the variance was known, and then we can approximate it as a normal distribution, but the sigma squared is unknown, and then typically what we do is to change this normal distribution with the t distribution, right? And so similarly, we can obtain this kind of interval. And then tolerance limits. So there are maybe a page or two about this tolerance in, limits in your book, but we will skip this part. Okay. I read those pages many times, but I couldn't understand that part. And also I looked at the Wikipedia and other books, I still don't understand. So if I if I don't understand even after so many hours, then I think you guys don't need to understand that. Okay. So again, we will skip this part. And then we move on to this two sample, and then estimating the differences between the two samples. So just like the previous chapter, where we extended one single population and then one single sample, and then extended it to a slightly different situation where we have two different population, and then we obtain two different samples from each, and then consider their differences, right? And so, yeah, we are doing kind of same thing in this chapter or this section. So we we want to estimate this guy mu 1 minus mu 2. So each of the population and their random variable is following some distribution with the mu 1 and mu 2 as their means, and sigma 1 squared, sigma 2 squared as also variances of these two populations. And then we want to estimate the differences between their true mean value. And that's our new parameter that we want to estimate. And then using, as our estimator for this true value, we just simply consider the difference between these two sample means. And then let's assume the first sample has the size, we obtained n1 samples and n2 samples from the first and the second population respectively. Okay. And then we know, x1 bar is following the normal distribution with the true mean value of mu 1 and sigma 1 squared divided by n1, right? X2 is also following the normal distribution with its own mean and the variance divided by its own sample size, right? And so we consider x1 bar minus x2 bar, and so we are doing Gaussian minus Gaussian, or normal minus normal, and thus it will be still a normal. And then we still need, we only need to consider, it's just enough to consider their mean and the variance. And so the mean is this value, okay, and then the standard, the variance will be simply the summation of these two, because they are statistically independent, right? And then if we consider the standard deviation of them, their standard deviation will be this guy, okay? So this guy will be the standard error of this random variable, okay? And then the remaining part will be the same, exactly the same, right? So even though it seems like the equations or this kind of mathematical expressions gets more and more complicated, and so it may be a little daunting, so it may, you may feel, it's even more difficult, right? You don't need to, it's just a straightforward extension, right? It's a slight variation if you see, if you get some high-level insights, right? So this guy and this guy that follow, this guy is the distribution that this guy is following, and then this guy is the standard error term, okay? And so we only have different choices of the distribution and also different computations of standard deviation or variance. Okay, so you only need to consider those things. Okay, and then the next extension, as you might familiar by now, is to replace the to replace this standard the true variance by the sample variance. Okay, but here in this case, we consider the two population have the exact same variance, but these variances are unknown. Okay. Then this guy is an interval estimate to be 95 confident. Okay, and in this case, yeah, this guy will have the will follow the t distribution, but interestingly, the degree of freedom will be n1 plus n2 minus 2. Okay, so there is a little bit more, yeah, there is a something that we have to think about in order to understand this interval estimate. Okay, so we consider so-called pooled sample variance. So pooled sample variance. So that means, so pooled sample variance means so in this case, approximately x1 bar and x2 bar, and b1, then sample variance, sample variance divided by this guy is following the t distribution where the degree of freedom is n1 minus 1, right? And then, so this is a sample variance from population 1. And then x2, so this is a sample mean. So this is following another t distribution with the sample variance, the degree of freedom of n2 minus 1. Okay, so in this case, we consider this random variable of x1 bar minus x2 bar, right? So this guy is still following the t distribution, okay? And then this t distribution has the mean value of this guy. And then, yeah, so it is something like this. So we have these two t distribution, and then we consider their difference. I mean, one t random variable minus another t random variable, right? So somehow, although we do not prove this rigorously, this difference between these two t distributions will also follow another t distribution, okay? Another one single t distribution. And that is t distribution will have this part of some kind of this kind of representation, which we have to have in the denominator in the t distribution, right? Okay, so yeah, somehow this part is changing into this part where we have chi-square distribution divided by its own degree of freedom. And then this degree of freedom is this n1 plus n2 minus 2, n2 minus 2, okay? And then how we compute this single sample variance is as follows. So again, if we want to change this sample mean and their expression in this form, x bar minus mu, and sigma divided by square root n, and then if we change this sigma into this sample variance, I mean the square root of sample variance, then this one will follow the t distribution, right? So that is the high level story that we repetitively used, but in this case, when considering this difference between these two sample mean, they will still follow one single t distribution. And then, when considering the t distribution, we have to have the true mean value that is corresponding to this part, and also we have to have one single covariance, I mean, not the covariance, the sample variance value, right? And that sample variance value is actually considered or computed in this form. So I can only give you some kind of intuitive explanation of it, but here's how we can compute one single or one common sample covariance. So initially you had two populations, and then they are assumed to have the same variance value, right? But these variance values are unknown. We do not know. So we have to replace them by the sample variance, right? And then by the fact that they have the same variance value, we can actually utilize two sets of samples to estimate one single sample variance. So here's how. So suppose you have two population, and then you obtain like five samples, and then maybe eight samples. Okay, and then how do you compute the sample variance? We compute xi minus x bar squared divided by summing up over all the five samples, and then divided by five minus one, right? And then in this case we do the same thing. So this, let's call this x1i, x2i, and x2 bar. I equals 1 through 8, then divided by 8 minus 1. Okay? So from this, suppose this sample variance was like 3 squared. And then this one was giving you the sample variance of maybe 4 squared. But we assume that the true variance between these two population is the same, okay? But they are same different estimate of your sample, I mean the same variance, right? And so we can kind of average between these two. How we can average between these two is as follows. So we just compute this value and this value, and then we just add them together. And then divide it by the total denominator that we have to divide by. So we just compute the whole numerator based on this expression, and then we just divide it by the total degree of freedom like this. So in this case, in this case, the sample variance will be n1 plus n2 minus 2, because 5 was n1, 8 was n2, and minus 2. Then summation over 1 through n1 and x1i minus x1 bar squared plus I equals 1 through n2, and then x2i minus x2 bar squared. Okay, so in this manner we can obtain one single estimate of your true variance value. Okay, so that is one nice way of computing one single estimate from these two samples, right? Okay, so this is called pooled sample variance. Sample variance. And pooled means you actually pull those into kind of one pool, okay? So pool is just one single pool, okay? One single basket, and then you just dump different sets of samples into one basket, and that's why we call that as pooled. Okay, and that pooled covariance is is actually playing a role in the new single T distribution. Okay, so So from this notation, this part is the same as the definition of the pooled variance. So S1 squared is just the typical definition of sample variance of population 1, right? And then S2 squared is the sample variance from the population 2, right? And then we just multiply with the degrees of freedom, right? And then divide it by the total degrees of freedom, and then divide it by the sigma squared, and then this guy will follow the this guy is the same as V divided by N, where V is chi-square distribution, okay? So this part, okay? So this part is is working as a denominator to define this guy, okay? So here we have this sample mean differences and the true mean difference, and then what is this guy? This guy is this guy came from here. So x1 bar, x2 bar is following having the sample variance of sigma 1 squared divided by n1, sigma 2 squared divided by n2. Okay, so this part, this guy is appearing in the denominator, so that this whole numerator is becoming a z. Okay, so this becomes z. Okay, and then this denominator is square root v divided by n, right? So that's why that's how we obtain the t distribution from this equation or this transformation. Okay, so once we manipulate them, and then using the definition of this pooled variance, then we can obtain we can manipulate this whole representation with this representation that follows the t distribution with the degree of freedom of this guy, n plus n1 plus n2 minus 2. Okay, so from modeling this random variable with the t random variable, we can obtain this kind of interval estimate when we know when we do not know the true variance value, but we assume that this guy, and using this we utilized this pooled sample variance. Okay, then the last case is sample variance is unknown, but at the same time see. Yeah, those two, those two true variants are unknown, and also they are not the same. So in these cases, we can no longer use the sample, the pooled variance. I mean, pooled sample variance like this. Okay? Because those two sample variance estimate will be corresponding to different true parameter, sigma 1 squared, sigma 2 squared, which are two different values. So in these cases, they still follow the T distribution, but their degree of freedom, which is a parameter for the T distribution, is defined in a really complicated manner. Okay, but in this case, I also cannot prove this, and the book doesn't have a proof, and also I couldn't easily find the proof of it. And it utilized some approximation technique, but I don't think this is a scope of our class. But at a high level, you can understand as follows. So still considering the difference between the two sample means, when the sample variances are unknown, and then we can still model them as a T distribution. But the degree of freedom is defined in this complicated manner that we do not know. But when two true variances are the same but unknown, and then we can we can understand their degree of freedom from this notion of pooled sample variance. That's it for today. Thank you very much, and see you this Wednesday.
T-distribution을 표현하면 이거다 정도만 알면 되는 거예요?
아, 그러니까 이게 T가 그러니까 Z가 있고요.
네.
Z의 분모에는 스퀘어루트 안에 chi-square divided by 그 degree of freedom이 있는 거잖아요. 그러니까 이게 일단 기본적으로 Z예요.
네.
그리고 이게 우리가 샘플 variance를 그러니까 variance를 안다고 생각하면 이거를 직접적으로 그냥 쓰는 거죠.
네.
이게 스탠다드 노멀 랜덤이라고 해갖고 이제 인터벌 에스티메이트를 할 수가 있는 건데
네.
이게 저기 이 시그마를 모를 때는 이제 이 식을 어떻게 하냐면 요거를 이제 시그마로 했다고 했을 때는 아 여기 스퀘어루트가 일단 있어야 돼요.
네, 네. 네.
이거를 이렇게 매니플레이트를 그러니까 식을 잘 조절을 하면 이런 식으로 네. 바꿀 수가 있다는 거고
네. 네.
그렇게 되면 여기서 이게 V예요, 기본적으로. 그러니까
네.
S1 제곱에 N1-1. 개수만큼 해도. 예, 이게 그러니까 pooled variance에서 각각의 샘플 민으로부터 얼마나 그 각각의 샘플들이 차이가 나느냐. 그걸 제곱한 것들이잖아요. 그거의 총 합이고 이것도 마찬가지로 그런 식으로 population 2로부터 나온 제곱들의 합이고요.
네.
거기다가 이 degree of freedom, N1, N2-2를 해주면 이게 곧 chi-square distribution, 요거 이 시그마 제곱으로 나누어지면 이게 chi-square distribution이 되고 여기다가 이 degree of freedom으로 나누면 이게 곧 V, 여기까지에 해당하는 V 나누기 이 degree of freedom이 된다. 그렇게 돼서 이게 T distribution이 된다라고. 하면
되게 정도 빠져요.
네.
감사합니다.
네.
그냥 개인적으로 보고 건데
네.
이렇게 있는 슬라이드를 직접 추가하신 거예요. 막 피어슨에서 공식적으로 준 자료하고 좀 다른 것 같아서.
어 맞아요. 네. 내가 좀 추가해서. 아 이거 슬라이드가 너무 디테일이 없어가지고요.
네. 너무 없어서.
잘못해서.
네.
피어슨에서 준 거를 쭉 뽑아놨는데.
아 그랬어요?
네. 보다 보니까 없더라고.
네. 아 이게 강의 자료가 해도 넘어갈 정도로 디테일이 없어가지고
그냥 진짜 번호 매긴 것만 나온 것 같아요.
맞아요. 그래서 뭐 그냥 조금 뭐 부족하지만 내가 조금 추가를 해서 올린 거는 그럼 추가한 게 반영이
됐어요. 네, 네.
네.
감사합니다.
네.
제일 마지막
그, 제가 그 채점 관련해서 메일을 보냈었는데
네, 아직 답장을 안 줬나요?
아니, 아니 제가 그
네.
매일 제 메일이
네.
삭제에 대해서
네.
제 실수로 그
네.
블랙보드 정보를 수정하기 전에
네.
교수님한테 메일을 보냈었거든요.
네.
이게 정상적으로 메일을 갔는지 궁금해서
아...
혹시 확인 김정환이요.
정환. 네, 그러면 이거는 내가 확인을 해볼게요. 이메일이 제대로 왔는지.
네.
네. 그래서 안 왔으면 내가 다시 다음 시간에 알려줄게요.
네, 알겠습니다.
네. 네. 네, 수고했어요.